And without further ado, let's get started.
Okay, and by the way, there's a handout for the for tonight's program. If you don't have one of these, there's some extras on the seats. Can somebody raise their hand if they know where the extras are?
They're right there. You got them there?
Okay, so if you need, and I also have a handout, one page that has 8 slides on it, front and back. So if you want to follow along and write notes, you can take it home, you can take that. So there's more people back there. Okay, so with that, we'll start. I have a little timer here. Okay, so does evolution falsify Adam as a first human? This is a topic that's really important to me. Let's go to the next slide. What evidence, okay, so here's the overview of what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about the evidence for evolution, and what some religious criticisms are, and then how do some people reconcile evolution with theology. John is not one who accepts evolution, so he doesn't have to do that, but I want to take a grand picture of some Christians who try that. Next page. Okay. So what evidence is there for evolution? I think since the year 2000, they've actually decoded the human DNA, all the human DNA for the first time, and since then they've decoded a lot of other animals, and they've compared the DNA across animals, and this is called genomics. It's a science. And with that, I think there's very two strong evidences for evolution. There's many of them, but I'm going to bring up two that I think are unassailable. So the first one, next page, is on pseudogenes. Let's go to the next page. There we go. See, what you see here is pseudogenes are basically genes, according to evolutionary theory, that we inherited from our ancestors, different species, and they're busted genes. So what this chart shows, for example, if you look at the very top, it says humans have 15 pseudogenes. Well, this is just part of the olfactory sense, part of the smelling, you know, the things that we smell, the odors. So for example, humans have 15 wrecked versions of this that they inherited. So in other words, we can't smell certain odors that other animals can. Chimps have a different 4, gorilla have 5, and orangutans have 11. These are all different, okay? So when you go down the tree there, you see the 3. The 3 is underneath the branch of humans and chimp. That means that humans and chimp inherit these 3 broken genes. The gorilla and the orangutan don't have it. If you go down to the next branch, you go to the common ancestor between the gorilla and the chimp and the human, okay? And there's 3 more there. So everybody underneath that inherited those 3. At the very bottom, there's 1 there. That 1 pseudogene is something that all of these species have inherited. So when you look at this, in every case of pseudogenes, they can see patterns of descent where a broken gene is inherited. And you might say, well, maybe it just evolved, maybe just modified in some way, and another one modified another way in a different animal, unrelated. Well, this is how you can see it happens according to ancestry. So either these are inherited, or else God designed creatures independently and made it look as if they descended, which would make God lying, deceiving God, which is not good for theology. So most Christians would not claim that. Let's go to the next page. It's fused human chromosome number 2. What this shows is that there's 1 less pair of chromosomes in humans and chimps. And since, again, the year 2000, they decoded the DNA, and we found out why humans have 1 less. It's because if you look at 2 of the chimp chromosomes, it looks like they fused, and then they're similar to the human. And now, how do we know that's how the human came about? Because at the end of every chromosome, they have what they call telomeres. And in the center of each chromosome, there's what they call a centromere. So when these 2 fused, there's these telomeres, which are normally at the end. Now they're also in the middle, because they met in the end, in the middle. And because of this also, there's 2 centromeres in there instead of just 1. And so when you look at the human fused genome, number 2, the chromosome number 2, you see the broken centromere in there, and then you see the accurate centromere being used, and that's the one that's in the bottom one. So basically, one of the centromeres atrophied, and one of them worked, and then the 2 telomeres in the middle are now deactivated. So again, either this perfectly explains how there's a relationship between humans evolving from some common ancestor, or else God, if he made humans from scratch, he put this in there to make it appear so. So you have to ask, why is God building things from scratch and putting in unused centromeres and extra telomeres and things like that? Just to, it looks like, again, he's a deceiving God. He did that on purpose. Next page. What criticisms are there? I'm going to go over some of these just basically really quickly. There's young earth creationists. They believe this is a small group of evangelical Christians, but they're very vocal, like Ken Ham with the Creation Museum in Kansas. And, you know, he has a thing called presuppositionalism, which means basically he starts with his belief and then he looks for evidence to confirm it. And he says, for example, when you find a fossil, it doesn't come with a tag and say this was made in the year, you know, whatever. He says creationists look at it through their mind, their worldview of 6,000 years, and evolutionists look at their worldview of, you know, millions or billions of years, and that's why they have different ideas. Well, that's not really the way science works. The way science works is you look at the data, you build a hypothesis, you build a prediction, you test it, and then revise accordingly. And one of the things that scientists hate, one of the things they look out for to demolish in themselves and others, is confirmation bias. That means you don't look just to confirm your own biases. You want to try to make sure that you're looking at the big picture and looking at it soundly and soberly. And so basically this presuppositionism, in my view, is actually just confirmation bias on stilts. You know, it's basically lifting up confirmation bias as if it's something good, when it's the thing that you really want to destroy in your own thinking. So confirmation bias is listed as a logical fallacy if you want to look it up on the internet for more information. Then there's also old earth creationism, where Reasons to Believe is a ministry website like that with Hugh Ross and Fazale Ron, and Ronna wrote a book called The Cell's Design, How Chemistry Reveals the Creator's Artistry. And basically the idea is that life is so amazing it must be designed. I mean, it's like the woman who looks at a baby in her arms and says, there must be a God, look at this baby, it's just so wonderfully made. You know, it's just struck by the complexity. But I think the antidote to that kind of thinking is, like, Richard Dawkins had a talk one time about what he called large world, medium world, and small world. And since we evolved in this medium world, we're used to things like minutes and miles, those kind of scales, but we can't comprehend things on the very small world or the very large world. So, for example, in the very small world, there's weird quantum effects, such as quantum tunneling, quantum entanglement, and these have no counterparts that we could experience in our kind of existence. And so for us, they're very perplexing. You know, how do we explain that? We can't. We're still trying to figure out that stuff in the small world. We can't say it's like this in our world because it operates totally different. But some people don't understand that, and they say, oh, it's just hard to believe, okay. And it's like they prefer to believe in magic. Oh, God did it by magic. How do you make light? How is lightning made? Who made it? God made it, you know. And then they found out how are earthquakes made, but God made it. But then they found out, like tectonics, you know, same thing with tsunamis. So basically science is really discovering things that just are really counterintuitive to us because of our experience. So, and then intelligent design, this is promoted by the Discovery Institute. Basically it's a wide tent of everybody who disagrees with evolution. And there's a big mix in it, a wide mix, like Michael Behe is in there, for example, and he accepts that humans evolved from other animals like apes, but some of them don't. But they all reject that you could have just nature creating this without a God. Okay, next page. So how do Christians reconcile this? Well, Catholics have been known to accept evolution, but one thing the Pope has said, and nobody has really counteracted this in 1950, is he basically said, you know, evolution's fine as long as you believe we all descended from one man, Adam and Eve. Well, the problem is evolution works over population and time. At no point does a human pop out of a non-human. Again, I'll say that. At no point does a human pop out of a non-human. It works in populations over time. That's how all changes work. There's no such thing as a first fish, no such thing as a first human, a first frog, a first rabbit, first any species. So anyway, that's a problem that the Pope has. He basically says you're not allowed as a Catholic to believe that we basically came from a population of hominids. He believes that we all came from Adam and Eve and inherited that. So basically, I'm just going to jump to my conclusion now, and that is, let's go to two more, skip the next one, one more. So basically, I want to say, you know, I don't mean this as an insult. This is really how I believe. I really do believe that God does not exist, just like Santa Claus does not exist. Just as Santa Claus is in your mind as an imaginary character, I think that's the same about God. So I'm not saying that to put anybody down, that's just honestly how I feel. And I think that when you see the world through naturalistic eyes, things will make sense. But as long as you try to keep the ancient scriptures with modern science, there's always going to be a problem. So, time's up. Thank you.
All right. Is this on? All right. Thank you, Bernie, for your comments and thoughts on the matter before us. I have a couple quick questions. These are rhetorical questions. I don't think, Bernie, you're a biochemist. Is that fair?
True.
Fair. You're not a biochemist. And you mentioned a moment ago that...
Can you hold the mic up closer, please?
You say that you're a someone who's critiquing those who are presuppositional in their thinking. Do you think you're presuppositional in your thinking?
Not at all.
Not at all. Okay. All right. We'll carry on then. So this past week, Bernie and I met for lunch to discuss the topic before us, and I explained to him, as I'll explain to you, that I think this topic is of critical importance. It's not a secondary matter. It's not a matter that we can, as Christians or non, lightly pass over. The topic is very, very complex, as one can imagine. We're not just talking about, you know, a small group of Bible thumpers and what they think. We're talking about the origins of the human race. We're talking about the implications that come from that. There's a lot of things that go into this topic, there's a lot of details and matters that go into this that that we could spend an hour for next week talking about each one of them, or that wouldn't even suffice. The Genome Project, which Bernie is referencing tonight, is not something I'm an expert on, and I must submit to you, neither is it something Bernie is an expert on. There is a varied, wide range of opinions on the detailed research that is happening within the Genome Project, but I will suffice to say that I think that there's sufficient differentiation in the beliefs regarding that ongoing research, that I don't think there are any sound conclusions that can be drawn in a forum like this. I'm not a biochemist, I'm not a physicist, I'm not an astronomer, I'm not an astrophysicist, I'm not a scientist of any description. I'm just a lay Christian. I do believe that the Bible is faithful in its explanations of human origins. I believe that the Bible is faithful in the things that it teaches us about science, about inquiry. I do not believe that the Bible is a textbook, so there are certain things that the scriptures are silent on. I think that's fair to say. I will say this about what the Bible teaches about first things. It says that God created all that we see, all that we have, ex nihilo, out of nothing. It says that he did so for his own glory as a non-created being outside of time and space. It says that he created man, male and female, after his own image. He ensouled us, that is, he gave us life with his own breath. He gave us souls. He made us after his image after he had created the rest of creation. There are scriptures that I could allude to would describe very clearly what figures in the New Testament, Christ plus the apostles, thought of the Genesis account. In Mark 12, Jesus speaks of the book of Moses. He accepts as fact the book of Genesis. Paul in Romans 5 speaks of, and this is really clear, really important, he speaks of the first and the second Adam. Paul and the apostles along him and the church throughout time has believed that Adam is a real historical figure. It's not something that has ever been debated within the church until modern times. I'll come back to that passage in a few minutes. There are many people who are trying to reconcile natural selection and modern evolution is compatible with evangelical Christianity. So they have quickly jettisoned the idea of a historical Adam. They've given up the plain reading of Scripture. In my estimation, this is a grievous mistake of both an intellectual and a theological, massive intellectual and theological proportions. It's up to Bernie tonight to prove that Adam doesn't exist, not me. If you are a Christian in the audience tonight, before you sheepishly throw away Adam, and trust the Bible speaks not on these matters at all, on the matters of human beginnings, please consider that science actually is unable to contradict Scripture. Also consider that the historicity of Adam is a matter of first importance. This isn't, for example, a question about if you believe the supernatural events of the Old Testament. This isn't whether Jonah was swallowed by a fish or a whale. This isn't biblical scholars trying to figure out whether it was a large whale or whether it was a whale shark. This is a matter of first importance. This isn't whether or not the Exodus account describes the Israelites wading across the mouth of the Nile during a drought in the mud, or whether, like Charlton Heston style in the Ten Commandments, there's a 200-foot wall of water on either side of the Israelites as the seabed is laid before them. This is prime and critical in the theology of what it means to be a Christian. If you get rid of Adam, you get rid of a coherent doctrine of original sin. There's no purpose for Jesus coming, period. If you get rid of Adam, then you have to get rid of the narrative of biblical history. It has to go. So let's move on from that. I want to make the case. This is very important. I told Bernie, no Adam, no gospel. It's the bottom line. That was our conversation Friday. The Bible presents Adam as a real historical figure, not unlike David or Moses. And when Jesus tells us of the parable of the sower, he's telling a story. The sower was not a real person. The ruler that he alludes to, the rich man with the various people that he was, those people answered to, those were figures, as opposed to the woman at the well who he presents the gospel to, and has her draw water for him. Then he finds out what, that she's got multiple husbands, and he teaches her how to love God. In a real encounter. That's a real story as opposed to a false story, or a truth story, we might call it. Adam is never treated as a truth story. So, the problem for Bernie is that while many in the academy believe the topic of human origins is a matter of settled science, it simply isn't. I'm glad you brought up Richard Dawkins. Patron saint of modern Darwinism, Richard Dawkins, was asked a few years back if it was possible that intelligent design, which I'm not a proponent of, by the way, I believe in specific creation, I do not believe in evolution, but nevertheless, there are Christians who do. There are people who try to argue that intelligent design, more of a long view, evolution Christianized perhaps, ought to be the answer. The question is, Dawkins was asked a few years back if it was possible that intelligent design could possibly be an answer for all that we have. And Dawkins answers, well, it could come about in the following way. It could be that at some earlier time, somewhere in the universe, a civilization evolved, probably by some kind of Darwinian means, probably to a very high level of technology, and designed a form of life that seeded onto perhaps this planet. Now this is a possibility, and an intriguing one. And I suppose it's possible that you might find evidence for that if you look at the details of biochemistry, molecular biology, you might find a signature sort of some designer. In other words, aliens populated the planet we sit on. He can't believe in God. He can't believe in an intelligent creator giving us life. He has to seed us from some world we haven't discovered yet. So then, why did Dawkins arrive at such a far-fetched position? Because, as noted, humanist, atheist, and Nobel laureate quantum physicist Roger Penrose states, science has, quote, absolutely no idea what has caused life to originate, evolve, or for humans to develop consciousness. I submit that modern secular humanism, couched as science, really doesn't have any answers. These are smart people tilting at windmills. It's actually a little worse than that, however. When I was 6 years old in 1975, Time magazine had on its cover in the middle of, I believe it was June, some week in June, that we were headed toward the next ice age. When I graduated high school 13 years later, we were told that the Earth was going to be underwater on the coastal regions because the Earth's temperature was going to rise by 3 degrees centigrade by 2050. And today, after 17 years of the planet not warming at all, we're told that it's no longer global warming, it's now climate change. Science doesn't have any verifiable data on what's actually happening just in the climate that we live in today. So the point of this relevance to this topic is be skeptical about what you're hearing. I don't believe your data. I believe your data is skewed, and I don't believe that your data has any relevance to whether Adam lived or didn't. So what I will say in conclusion is that the stakes are high. It causes us, if we get rid of Adam and Eve, to forsake the biblical narrative. It causes us to endure massive implications for the human race. There are implications for all of us if there's no first family, and they're huge. There are also a lot of questions that I admit I can't answer. I can't give you an age of the earth. I can't give you a precise chronology of the anthropological diaspora of the human race. I can't do that. But my Christian faith leads me to believe with confidence that I am here in a world created by God, and it operates according to God's natural laws, not mine, such as gravity. But God is not bound by these. Proof of that is he raised his son from the dead. And so Bernie and those who think like him are much more involved in a faith experiment than I am, because their faith has no trustworthy object. Mine is the second Adam, the one who was raised from the dead. Thank you. And you get questions, I believe. So we're going to do 5 minutes of questions each, and then we'll open it up to you.
All right.
Okay, I'm not really sure where to start. There was so much there. Okay, so I was putting forward the case. Number one, why I believe in evolution. I gave some evidence, and then also what some criticism was. As far as the technical evidence, it seems like, do you have any rebuttal to anything I said technically, or are you just going to say you have no comment on technical things like specifically pseudo genes and teased human chromosome number 2?
Before I answer your question, where did you get your data?
That's a good question. The first one was from a teaching video series from Dennis Bienema. He has a 10-part series on YouTube. I was actually there because I was a Christian a few years ago at a conference. And basically it's called Can a Christian Accept Evolution? And he's a Christian who's a biological scientist, and he goes through the evidence in the DNA and goes over much more. But this screenshot was actually from his video. And the fused human chromosome number 2 is from Kenneth Miller. He has a YouTube video. And he actually presented this information in the ID trial at Dover. And he said it was really interesting because the ID folks, you know, they usually countered a lot of the evidence, but they didn't say one word about this, not one thing. Like, they couldn't say anything. So it's kind of an interesting anecdote.
So you're asking me to comment on your evidence?
I'm asking you if you have any comments on the technical evidence I submitted.
The only thing I will present to you is that in my studies for this night, there are lots of things that led me to question the data. Not this particular data, because I haven't studied it, but what I can tell you is that, for example, one study that I read about, talking about how the ENCODE project has proven that the chimpanzee and the human being are 97-98% similar in their DNA, was actually made up of skewed data sets that once the DNA stopped appearing normal, they stopped studying it, stopped appearing similar. So in fact, if you really extrapolate the DNA strands out as far as you can go, chimpanzees and human beings are only like 70% similar. Which would make a human being about as similar to a chimpanzee as it is to a pig.
Yeah, so, but the same code project is not referring to what I'm talking about. See, the argument is not that the code is similar. The argument is that we can see signs of descent that these broken genes are shared among ancestral relationships. In other words, for example, humans, in other words, never is a pseudogene observed out of sequence in ancestral. So basically, there's an inheritance thing going on. So it's not just simply that the code looks similar. It's actually inheriting broken genes. And we know they're broken because they actually perform a working function. You know, for example, humans and primates have to eat vitamin C because we have a busted gene to make ascorbic acid, which is vitamin C. But other creatures that we have a common ancestor from, they make their own vitamin C. And they can actually look in the genome and actually kind of know where to look for these. And lo and behold, there it is, boom, and it's busted. So things are in the right spot, they're just broken. Also about the...
I don't believe your data.
Okay.
I'm sure there's somebody that's much more learned than me that can give you an intelligent answer as I described. I'm not a biochemist.
Okay, I just want to mention, you mentioned the ENCODE project. From my understanding, that's a project of some anti-evolutionist Christians. And I, like I said, this guy who made this video, this is with the group called the American Scientific Affiliation, the ASA. I used to do that when I was a Christian. And he basically wrote against how some of their bad methodologies and all this stuff on this website called BioLogos, which is a evolutionary creationism website. These are creationists. They call themselves creationists, but they also believe in evolution. They say God used evolution as his design means. And, you know, they have their own criticism of, you know, the ENCODE project. So, you know, from what I can tell, the ENCODE project is not respected in the scientific community. As far as the academia, I mean, it's like evolution is taught in every state university in science, and creationism is not taught in any state university of science. So it's a lot more serious than just secular humanist promoting.
Was there a question in there, Bernie?
Yeah, sorry, I kind of went off. I just went on the ENCODE. So we're almost out of time. Do you have anything more to say technically as far as the technical evidence?
No, I don't. But I have a question for you.
Okay, my time's up, I guess.
So, how would you respond to Darwin's famous quote? And it goes like this. And let me frame the question a little further after I read it. To suppose that the eye, with all its imitable contrivances for adjusting the focus to different distances, for admitting different amounts of light, and for the correction of spherical and chromatic aberration, could have been formed by natural selection seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. Everybody knows that quote. The question I have for you, on a very practical sense, and if you could take 15 billion years, which you say the universe has to exist, the Earth has to have existed for that long to explain the development that we see before us in terms of evolutionary development, what good is an eye in light of Darwin's comment? What good is an eye? Why would it continue to evolve if it does the organism that has now received it, it does it no good?
Mm-hmm. Let me just say too that just in general, that like this question is actually really easy to answer with Google.
Good, because you'll be the first one that's ever answered.
No, I mean, I just Googled this a few days ago, and it kind of talks about from A to Z. But so first off, you need to say the rest of the quote, right? You know what the rest of the quote says?
I'm not actually familiar.
Okay, see, basically this is a very common thing about taking a quote out of context.
But you gotta answer the question I asked you. Okay. It's my question.
Yeah, but I mean, just, you know, a Christian knows it's an evil thing to do for somebody who's an anti-Christian to make a quote out of context. And so what happens is the next few lines basically undermine the whole point of what you just tried to say about that.
Then bring us into knowledge.
Okay, yeah. So basically, it's like the question is, what good is half an eye? And there's a whole bunch on the internet about plenty good about half an eye. First of all, the eye can start off just as light sensitive. And that's a huge advantage. And then if it's in a cup, as it develops, if it gets placed in a cup, then it can start to sense direction. And then if it starts to get a translucent covering, it can start to have a lens action. And it talks about the basic pinhole camera idea that even if you're just looking through a pinhole, it sharpens focus. So it looks like in nature there are gradations of the eye. So half an eye, yes, is very, very helpful compared to no eye. Having light sensitivity is very powerful.
You really believe that?
Sure. Yeah, you would rather have a light-sensitive patch of skin than be totally blind.
Okay. All right, thank you, Bernie. All right, moving on. Next question for you is, if evolution is the correct explanation of human and animal beginnings, then how do you explain that mutations today that are actually observed in nature are usually lethal and not, in fact, beneficial to the organism? We don't observe in the human race today people that are developing these brand new senses that nobody else has. When we mutate, we die of cancer. Mm-hmm.
Well, there are some mutations. Actually, one example of a mutation that's out in nature is PCBs. I believe that's some kind of plastic or maybe nylon mixture or something. That it turns out that there is some kind of, I can't remember what it is, a bacteria or something that developed an ability to eat that. And that's a man-made chemical that never existed before in all of life. And two of these genes that were, for some other purpose, came together to create this gene to give the ability to do that. So that's actually a demonstration that they talk about in science for a new feature arising out of existing. But anyway, I can't remember the question. Oh, you're saying there's a lot of failures and mutations. That's correct. But the human genome is really big and messy, like I said, because of all the serial genes. And if you have like an extra copy, if that extra copy of genes is free to mutate. Sometimes some plants or animals have a whole copy, extra copy of genes in certain segments, and that's basically a playground for the body to try. So,
okay. Thank you. Yeah. All right, next question real quickly. Do you find the alien seeding of this planet a more acceptable theory of how we got here than the idea of God creating us ex nihilo?
Well, I think the way Dawkins answered that was actually, wasn't really wrong with that. It seems like it was kind of spun by the way you presented it. The way I see it was somebody asking a scientist, if it did come from outer space, is that possible? How would that happen? So like, let's say we figured out that would happen. He's saying, well, if it turned out that life came from outer space, I suppose we would see signs in the DNA of it, you know? He's thinking as a scientist, if that hypothesis was true, what kind of predictions could we make? And that's all he was talking about. He wasn't saying that he thought it came from aliens. The question was, if it came from aliens, how could that happen, right? So he's just talking like a scientist. He's trying to explore a hypothesis. He didn't say there was evidence in the DNA that it came from outer space. He was saying if it did, there would probably be evidence in there.
Okay. All right, the floor is yours, people. So if you want to ask questions, for the sake of everybody involved, Bernie and me, we would ask you to speak with courtesy, clarity, conciseness. So speak with words of kindness and respect, and choose your words carefully so we can get as many questions as we can. Be as brief as you can. And if you want to come to the microphone here, we will call on you one by one, or if you want to stand up where you are, we won't embarrass you and make you come forward. So the floor is yours. Have at it.
And whether you come forward or not, you're not going to be picked up by the camera, so just your audio.
So we'll call on you. Jeff, come on up.
So I got a question for Bernie. You made a comment, first of all, that there's nothing a scientist, I'm just kind of paraphrasing, there's nothing a scientist hates worse than a presupposed or a coming at a question with a presupposition or argument.
Confirmation bias was the word, yeah.
Can you give, using the scientific method, any evidence for macroevolution?
Yeah. The evidence I just gave about the DNA, they call this, it's like digging through, it's like genomic archaeology. It's you can see history now. It's almost
that's
like you're seeing
microevolution.
What's that?
That's microevolution.
No, I'm talking about across different species, even like rat, mouse, people, chimps. You can compare their DNA and see the footprints of descent, you can see bits changing that don't even have to change. You know, okay. I could explain that more if you want me to.
No, that's okay. I've had enough genetic classes, but can you give an example of using the scientific method of a species jump? So, or a genus jump. Not species, species we can see. I'm okay with small changes, but a large change.
Okay, well, I think one thing you're getting at is that the scientific method has to do with setting up maybe an experiment and then falsifying or validating it in some way. There's another way of doing a test, and that is like when Einstein came up with this theory of general relativity, it involved a solar eclipse. And by measuring how the light is bent around that, it would prove his theory correct, or you know, it would give support to his theory. So in the same way, you can look at, you can say, of course, there's really two hypotheses. Either humans evolved from other animals, or they're made from scratch, boom. Okay, and then each hypothesis has its own consequences. And those, when you look at those consequences, you can look at the DNA and say, now let's look at the animals. What would you expect to see if there was a creation by God, ex nihilo, on each one, or if they descended from other animals? What would you expect to see? And what you expect to see with descent is what we do see. And it doesn't make any sense with a special creation unless you think God is a deceiver, because...
No, not at all. Not at all. But I guess my question, which is still not being answered, is can you set up, using the scientific method, some sort of test that when we look back over time, whatever the length of time that is, where you have mammals branching off, where you have, not using genetics, but using, can you give an example today, other than genetics, of some sort of macroevolution taking
place? Okay, so why would this not count as a test if you say, let's take the DNA of a bunch of different species, sequence it, and then compare it? Well, why is that not a test?
If you accept genetic testing, then it's okay, but I don't accept that.
Why not?
When I was in school, I was a biology major, and I studied spiders in North Carolina. And a lot of the genetic tests that we looked at when we were first doing all of our genetic tests, we associated certain characteristics of certain spiders to certain genes and determined in the end, well, actually long after I was out of school, but looking back, well, that really wasn't what we thought it was. So I don't put my faith in things that people are thinking about today, because that changes.
Let me ask you though, I mean, as a geneticist or whatever, do you understand what pseudogenes are?
Yeah, I'm not a geneticist.
Okay, but do you understand what pseudogenes are, since you worked in biology?
Pseudogenes was not a topic when I was in school. No. Okay. So I'm just saying, okay, I was looking for something larger.
Yeah, well, I mean, your example is not a relative test to show macroevolution, but what I'm proposing about comparing across, you know, DNA across species, I think that's very relative to show macroevolution. I don't see why that doesn't count.
So I'll leave it with this. I think that you're prescribing what you want to see in that, not necessarily what's there. Because it could change next week.
No, it can't change. I mean...
All right, that's fine. Thank you.
Yeah, well, the data we won't have won't change, but we could get additional data. That's true. Additional data might see a fuller picture and change things.
Next. Bernie, I'm just curious, if you're an atheist, what is the point of life for you? I'm just curious.
Mm-hmm. Basically, the biggest thing in life for me is just enjoying life, enjoying the moment, appreciating the short time we have.
Question back there.
Yes, Master Thomas.
And by the way, I don't mind general random questions. I don't know if you do or not. Some people want to be on topic. It doesn't bother me if we go off topic.
So, Mr.
Dehler,
how did fish evolve in legs?
Well, there are some fish that have legs, I think, even now, or they've found fossils. I can't remember which one it is, but you know, they got a handfish. Have you heard of that fish? Look up handfish in Australia. It's got these kind of hands that hold on to the gravel, I think. And they've got lungfish, fish that have lungs. They can breathe outside of water. So it seems like these are almost transitionary fossils that you're looking for. So that might be an interesting thing to do on Google, is look at Google evolution and fish together and see what pops up.
Yeah, for Bernie. Sorry, Bernie. I should sit down if anybody wants to ask John a question, because a lot are going to Bernie, and I could. What's that?
I got a question.
Why don't you go first, John? Not any of that, but I would like to be line of questions. Quick.
John, can you talk about the doctrine of the fall and what that means and what implications that has for life looking as ugly and as distorted and as broken as we see it today?
Certainly. So when Paul talks to us in the book of Romans, which may not be of interest to you if you're a secular humanist or if you're not a Christian, certainly, but the Apostle Paul speaks in the book of Romans, and he says the following. He says, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all sinned, for sin was indeed in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses. I'll just skip ahead a little bit. But the free gift is not like the trespass, for if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God and the free gift by the grace of that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. So the idea there is that Adam was the first of the human race, the representative head. And for a Christian, and for non-Christian alike, if that's true, if Adam is indeed the first human being, if God in real space and time decided to begin the human race, if that's true, then that has implications on everybody sitting in this room, and everybody that's ever lived, and everybody that ever will live. If that's not true, if Bernie's supposition is correct, that there is no Adam, there are no first human parents that God had a special relationship with. If we are just space, time, chance, certain metabolic substances, then of course that's all nonsense. And for some of you in the room, that's exactly what it is. But I'm telling you that for a Christian, the idea of original sin is the path to the Savior. The idea of original sin, through death and Adam, comes in Genesis, the third chapter, verse 15. The Savior to come, the first mention of Jesus Christ in the first book of the Bible, then that's what the Old Testament is about. That's certainly, of course, what the New Testament is about. So the idea of original sin, that sin that is found in Adam when he fell into sin, when he sinned in the garden, that is, for a Christian, that's literal truth. So, anyway, I could answer.
Can I briefly say something?
I would love for you to say something, Bert.
You know, sometimes when I do a debate like this, they say, well, why are you debating somebody who doesn't believe in evolution? Why don't you debate a Christian that believes in evolution? So just to throw this out there, too, I used to be an evolutionary creationist before I left the faith. And one thing they would say, like the guy who said, I know the guy who wrote the book, Dennis Lamoureux, he basically says, yes, we're sinners, but of course, you know, Paul talked about Adam and Eve, he didn't know any better, and, you know, it's not a science textbook. So he'd say, yeah, we're sinners. How do we get to be sinners? We don't know. We just know Jesus died on the cross for our sin, and, you know, we just know the gospel. We don't know why we're sinners or how that came about. And for me, I didn't want to do it, so me and John agree on this, that I mean, I just thought, you know what, just be intellectually, have the intellectual courage just to follow the evidence where it leads, and I don't want to hold on to this because it doesn't make any sense anymore. But just put it out there that there are people who say, sure, I fully accept science, and the Bible has nothing to do about science, and if I can't figure out where sin came from, no big deal. Just, you know, don't think about it. Just think about your relationship with Jesus. You know, that's what he would have said. And it was just too mystical for me.
Two comments on that. Number one, I wholly reject the idea that Christians cannot be scientists. Of course they are. If you want to get rid of Christian scientists, I don't mean the denomination or the offshoot. I mean Christians who are scientists. Then you have to get rid of a whole bunch of people that have done a whole lot of good for this world and for the kingdom of God. So that's a straw man. So the idea that one can be an intelligent, well-reasoned individual and believe in a God who created us, that's just foolish talk, in my opinion. The second thing is, I wholly believe what you just said, that if you try to synthesize what cannot be synthesized, you're going to end up where you are, Bernie, which is in unbelief.
Can I comment on that, Harvey?
Please.
So, I feel like I'm a truth seeker as well, so I relate to that part. And the more that I study history, I've been homeschooled. I've homeschooled my kids, and so it's led me on a path to want to learn more about history and science and language and all these different subjects. And as I study more and as I watch lectures and things like that, the scriptures point to the same truths that I'm learning about in these different fields and categories, and they just are revealed in truth. Like, they're all wrapped up in truth. And so I'm curious, as you say, you're a truth seeker, how much of the Bible have you studied to see if what it says is true? For instance, prophecy being fulfilled and the probability of those prophecies being able to be fulfilled and putting your faith in things that are proven over time. My husband's very data-driven. And so we have a lot of discussions about data, because data can be skewed, and you can't see everything when you're so narrow focused on one thing. And so, like, this pseudo-genomes or whatever you're talking about, it's very hard for me to follow you when you're presenting that specific thing, because it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And we can find patterns in lots of things. And when you talked about like God being a lying God, you know, if he were to put those things in there, could it be that he created many things and it has footprints of his design all over, you know, the same things throughout, just like we create things and we have our fingerprints all over it, you know, like a designer would maybe use the same sort of legs or stools or those types of things throughout their designs. But my biggest question is, have you really, like really sought the truth in the Bible to see its misgivings and...
Okay. Well, I'm a little older than I look. I'm actually 52. That surprises some people.
I can't be, Bernie.
I grew up as a Roman Catholic. I was confirmed as Roman Catholic. After college, I became a born-again evangelical Christian. And then went through all the different phases from younger creationism, older creationism, ID, that's intelligent design. I wanted to actually start a church. And I went to, I've been involved in Bible studies, leading Bible studies and ministries, preaching the gospel on TV. I got a master's in ministry degree while I was working. So I got one of those in 2007. And in 2009, I left the faith. So I left a few years, just 5 years ago, actually. So yes, I'm not impressed with prophecies. I don't think they're valid at all. As far as, you know, you said God could put fingerprints in the genome. Well, it's not fingerprints. They're garbage. They're busted genes. There's thousands of them. It's not just one or two, three pseudogenes. It's just all throughout the entire genome. And then you can actually look at these as markers through descent. I mean, why would God make a human from scratch and then make it look as if he took two other chromosomes and smashed them together, and you have these fragments all over the place. You know, I mean, they're fragments, leftover fragments, because we know what a telomere and a centromere is, and they don't have that purpose when they're smashed together anymore, and the fragments are in there still. So, I mean, it's obvious what happened here. So, why would God be so sloppy to cram things there when he's so brilliant to create the whole universe from a big bang? I mean, it doesn't add up. You know, a person, if they're designing a brand new computer, they might be sloppy because they got to get time to market and do this thing really quick, but somebody as brilliant as God wouldn't be smushing things together and having all these rudeness and stuff around. I don't know if this, and why would they do it according to the sense? It just doesn't add up. But if you look at it naturally, it's like, wow, it makes perfect sense. The only problem is trying to accept it, having courage to say, I'm going to accept the truth wherever it leads. It goes against what I wanted to believe. And I came to this point where I would believe in God if I could just have a thread, just a thread to hold on. And I no longer even had a thread. So that's why I left the faith.
I was studying history, and I read a book on Herodotus and the histories of Herodotus. And then I've been reading in Daniel and the prophecies there with the kingdoms. And then I was reading the Revelations with the prophecies there. And this is over several years. And then I watched a video called The Star of Bethlehem that was talking about the constellations and the wise men following the stars. But historically, it lined up with Daniel being to the east, and his descendants would have been in exile in Babylon. And so they would have came from the east to follow the star of Jesus. And just all of these things crossing over, and that they studied astronomy, and they understood the signs in the sky, and that these signs are in Revelations. I mean, there's so many things that are lining up that it's like, how can you not?
Well, you know, that's funny.
Have you studied those prophecies?
Yeah, you know, it's funny how the ancients used to study the stars to predict the future and everything. Of course, now it's nonsense, we all say.
But it's not nonsense.
It's astrology.
But
as a Christian, you know it's nonsense.
You
don't believe in astrology, do you?
Well, I believe that God marked the signs in the sky, and it's actually spoken in the Bible that God that God put names on the signs in the sky. And if you study, like, Revelations, it talks about the sun and the moon will be at her feet, and her feet being the virgin. And if you study the stars, you know, there's a virgin in astronomy, or in astrology. And if the astrology that Christians should not follow is that they should revolve their life around the stars, we should revolve our life around God. But God has put signs in the stars. You know,
that. Well, that's not typical Christian, traditional Christian.
Well, like I said, I'm a true seeker as well.
Okay. Let's, y'all, one back here, and then you can go next. Keith?
Yeah, I'd like to follow up just a bit on presuppositionalism. Bernie, you believe in the dating methods, I assume.
Sure.
Okay. They all work in a similar thing. The one element I'm going to try to focus on here just for a second, because I think you're also a presuppositionalist. I think everyone is. In fact, I think postmodern people have pretty much destroyed modern people in thinking that nobody's a presuppositionalist. But I'd like to try to go there with you just for a second. Okay, so let's just take carbon dating. We know the half-life of carbon, right?
Right.
That's how we do it.
Mm-hmm.
So we can actually date things that go back to, how far does carbon work? 50,000 years?
I don't remember the details on all the radiometric.
50,000 years.
There's a lot of different elements besides carbon too, but yeah.
We can take, you're right. We can do the same thing with a lot of things. Okay. So how do you know that carbon has a half-life of a certain amount of years? How do we know that?
I'm not sure. Probably by assuming that it's a uniform rate.
Observation, scientific method, right? You can observe it in items that we can study today. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
And they also know the amounts in the atmosphere and how it's increased from
right, by observation of the world, the scientific method, that's right, Rudy Dehler. How do you know that carbon dating had the same process 40,000 years ago that it has today?
Mm-hmm.
How do you know that?
Well, usually people make assumptions unless there's reasons to
Bingo. Go ahead.
Unless there's reasons to overturn that.
Bingo. You're right. I love the word you used, assumptions. Usually people make assumptions.
Right.
They have to make an assumption for 50,000 years ago because you can't test it.
And it's a reasonable assumption.
So, well, I just want to interrupt Bernie for a second here. It is, you say it's a reasonable assumption, but it's still an assumption, and it's an article of faith. You really have to believe that the processes were the same 40,000 years ago, which I actually agree with that, okay? I actually agree with that, folks. I just don't think it's a scientifically verifiable thing,
but it's
and
not
you have
random.
To take it by faith.
But it's not random, though. It's not like, oh, I believe...
I didn't say that. I said it's an assumption that you can't prove.
Yeah.
You cannot prove it with a scientific method. Okay. Another one, you just said in your talk...
But it is reasonable, though, right? That's reasonable because we have no reason to doubt it. And if they
oh,
do have reason to doubt
let's
it...
Let's just go there then for a second, then. It's reasonable.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You've told me before that our genes are not designed, and scientists say this, they're not designed for reasoning, they're designed for survival. Correct? Or is
well,
the selfish gene?
I would say they're intertwined. I mean, part of surviving is, you know, the smartest one is going to survive, especially when it comes to warfare.
But, again, you know that the scientists say this, that our genes are not made for reasoning, they're made for survival. And if that's true, then you have to assume that your logic is the right logic. You have to assume that because we're not made to reason. I disagree with that, but that's a scientific theory that proves that you have an assumption.
Well, you know, isn't it obvious, though, that people are not reasoning logically? There's been a lot of battles, human against human, World War I, World War II. The people who are not in reality are going to get nuked, literally.
How do you know what reality is and others don't?
Because of
reality. How do you know reality and John doesn't?
Because reality...
Right now, your genes, you're saying my genes are survivor genes, but they happen to logic right. And John's genes are survivor genes, and he has the logic wrong.
Well, see, it's really easy. Reality is what works. When somebody says, we're going to create an airplane, and another one says, well, we're going to cast spells, guess what? The one doing casting spells loses out. And then,
so it's just pragmatism, which, of course,
it's not pragmatism. It's like the rubber meets the road. It's
reality.
You get smacked around by reality when you're wrong.
You're not going to say that pragmatism doesn't have assumptions, are you?
Pragmatism?
Just what, it all comes down to just what works?
Well, the scientific...
That's what's right.
If it's true, it works.
Okay. Good enough, but I think you have plenty of assumptions. I think you're a presuppositionalist.
Did you want to add something?
I just wanted to say the thing about assuming that elements have certain properties in the past. You can actually take artifacts from different periods that we know are that old and test them pretty much dating and points to the right age. And you can also look at stars from different distances because it takes, like, a star is 1,000 light years away, it takes light 1,000 years to get here. So you can look at that star and if it emits the same forms of radiation and the same spectrum of radiation, then you know that the laws of physics operated the same way 1,000 years ago. And you can look at stars going back to about 14.7 billion years ago. And we can look at stars and galaxies from extreme distances away.
Assuming the speed of light is always the same.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, when you follow that logic where you have to keep inventing new laws of physics in the past, you end up having to assume more and more and more things.
My only point is, I agree with you. I happen to think, though, that there are assumptions even in what you said. I think there are assumptions you can't get away from.
I think one person is observing something and testing it, and the other person is assuming that things were magically different in the past. The observation beats the assumption.
Let's move on to this gentleman's question.
Sure. So, when I come to debates, I make a point trying to, I guess, critique both presenters. So, everybody's pretty much presented, and any questions Bernie I might have had, so my question is to you. You said much earlier on that the burden of proof is upon Bernie to prove that Adam did not exist. Now, one of the tenets of logic is that the burden of proof is upon the positive claimant. So my question for you is, what's the evidence that Adam existed?
That Jesus rose from the dead.
Well,
that Jesus, that Jesus is who he said he was, and the apostle who saw Christ said that Adam had to be the first Adam was the first human being created by God. And so the reason I asked Bernie to go first tonight, or actually, you know, it's Bernie's proposition tonight that Adam doesn't exist.
the reason we're here tonight is because Bernie wants to argue that Adam doesn't exist. I find it ironic that we're in a church with a cross and your PowerPoint is displayed next to it. You know, you're trying to undo Christianity. So, I mean, the reality is that your whole apologetic is that I used to be a Christian and I outgrew it. So if you're going to say in a society, in a Christian microcosm, you know, a culture like ours, that there are no truth claims that can be verified, I mean, your question is based upon a presupposition that there's no God.
Actually, no, my question is based on the same presupposition we have in our courts. The burden of proof is upon the positive claimant.
But your logic leads you to believe, true or false, that there is no God.
I'm not commenting on that either way, bud. I'm just here to...
Well, we don't have to give testimony, but you're saying that it's not logical.
No. I am still attending several churches, what I'm asking. I'm not saying it's not logical.
Okay.
What I'm saying is no one's ever given me evidence. What's yours?
That I'm here. And that God loves me. And that God has transformed me. And that there is a God because he says so. He testifies to himself. That God exists outside of all the stuff that we're doing right now.
Yeah, actually,
that's the evidence.
Actually, the topic of discussion tonight is not did Adam exist. The topic is, does evolution falsify Adam? And in that particular topic, Bernie takes the positive and John takes the negative.
Fair enough. It's okay to ask any question, though, too.
Yeah,
and you know, either one.
I don't shrink from the question.
No.
The Bible testifies to the glory of God. The Bible is God's inerrant word, as far as I see it. And not just me, but hundreds of millions of people before me. And I would say to you, hundreds of millions after me. And the scriptures, I believe, are true. So I have a question. If I'm a
question,
you get one, too.
But
if I ask a question, you get a question.
Just a little follow on this current question, though.
Sure.
He asked you, how do you know it's true that Adam was alive? And one of the things I think he says by faith that Jesus rose from the grave.
I believe that, of course.
Okay. Well, one of the things in the secular community circulating right now is that maybe you can comment on this: is that you don't know anything by faith. Faith is what you place your beliefs in, but faith is not a way of knowing. You can't say you know something because of faith. Faith is not a way of knowing anything.
I'll answer your question with a question.
Okay.
All right. So, a good gentleman who I've not met back there said, referencing 14.7 billion years ago, something happened. The Earth is 14.7 billion years old. And in processes that have been invented in the last 40 to 60 years, we can verify that. Okay? Fair enough?
Sure.
Is that a fair summation?
Yes.
Okay. So... you're going to ask me to drop everything I believe on the basis of what, let's say, the 300 or 500 or 1,000 smartest people in the world that you respect believe. Okay, so the noted geophysicists and scientists of all descriptions have come up with a set of theorems that say that we descend from all this and that the Earth is close to 15 billion years old. And you weren't there, and I wasn't there, and this next gentleman back here, I don't know, he wasn't there either. But I do have a question.
But you didn't answer my question, all right?
Not to answer your question. When it all began, who pulled the trigger, and how did it start?
No, I don't think anybody pulled the trigger. I don't think we know how it all started.
So if I read my... scientific material from when I was an undergraduate accurately, it comes down to there was a bunch of mass tightly packed together in a room about as big as, you know, a city block, and it blew up.
Well, the truth is nobody knows.
Nobody knows, that's right, right?
Mm-hmm.
But you can sit here and tell me that what I believe is completely foolish.
Right.
And yes, I can tell you that it's a whole lot more logical for me to believe something outside of space and time did what happened, than for you to tell me, nobody knows, we weren't there, it might have just happened. That's foolish.
Well, I could agree with you if something was outside of space and time, like multiverse theory, for example.
Can you prove that scientifically?
No, I said nobody knows.
I know.
He said, who pulled the trigger? That's like saying, who caused lightning? Who caused the earthquake? Who pulled the trigger on the Big Bang? Who? Why are you asking who?
the entire point of your worldview is to answer questions, and you don't have this first answer to that question. I do.
We don't have the answer to this beyond our knowledge.
Bernie,
so you can't pretend to know the answer if you don't know the answer.
I'm not pretending.
Okay, you don't
know the answer. God spoke to that. God spoke to that. God spoke to that. And it's true. And it's true for a whole lot of things that it's true in ways that you will perhaps never recognize.
Can you briefly, though, answer my question about, like I said, going to a secular community right now, there's this idea that you really can't know anything by faith. I mean, faith is not an epistemology. Faith is not a way of knowing. Do you agree with that?
What does it mean?
He believes based on authority. Someone else's authority that he believes.
Or you could believe something because what they've said has been proven true over and over and over again. And so you put your trust in that source.
Right. So you're placing your faith in something, but that's totally different than saying I know something because of faith. That's what I'm trying to say. You see that faith is not a way of knowing something.
Well, if all of the people before Christ believed in Christ's coming, and they know that what God says is true, and they believe in that truth, that's putting your faith in something that, if you know God is true and he is going to fulfill his promise, and he has fulfilled his promise time and time again, then that is faith and truth going hand in hand. Does that make sense?
No, I'm still trying to get the bottom line that can you know anything by faith? I understand you place your faith in faith. That's fine.
I know that Jesus raised himself from the dead. I know that.
You know it by faith?
I know it by faith. I know it by the testimony of those who saw Jesus and those who believed in Jesus before, and I know by the testimony of his
character. Okay, I just wanted to see if you said it, because a lot of Christians, I think, are saying, of course we don't know anything by faith, and so it's kind of interesting to hear you say that, so.
So, I could give you a lot of absurd examples, and I'm not a philosopher, and I'm not the best arguer in the world, but you have faith in the chair, right? Here's an absurd example. You sit down in that chair 1,000 times, right?
I place my faith in the chair, but I don't learn anything about the chair by faith in the chair.
And I place myself in the hands of Christ.
Right. I understand.
Because I know what he's done.
Right. That's placing your faith in something that's different than saying I know something because of faith.
I know that God loves me because of what Jesus did.
Okay.
If I could ask a question, you said you worked at, someone said you worked at Intel. Are you on the engineering side, or okay? So I used to be an engineer, and then I moved into management and stopped being an engineer. But the examples about the pseudogenes and the chromosomes, I think the genome project it can be very intimidating. And when you talk about the broken, the things in there that don't make sense are just busted. It made me think of like semiconductor fabrication. And this example should speak to us and maybe a few other engineers in the room. In that process, you know, chemical, mechanical polishing, where they work layers down, there's a concept called dummy fill, right? You know, where you put in other materials so that it planarizes properly. Mm-hmm. To the uneducated person, or I'd say the person that's not in semiconductors, if they were just to analyze them, like you have the logic, you have the memory, and just look at the chip through a scope, they would come to this area and say, this is busted. I don't know what the designer meant to do, but I'm saying that when we don't understand everything about the genome project, then maybe God, not a deceiving lying God, but a God who knows that we don't need to know, that has not yet been revealed to us, we may look at the genome and say, this is busted, this doesn't work. But it's like a child saying something, you know, that something that adults understand doesn't work. So that is faith. I know it's not logical, because we, in our own scope, our kids believe they know everything. Sorry. I believe they know everything, but we know they seem to know. I believe that this area of science, which it is an excellent trump card, it kind of shows, you know, none of us in here are saying we're biogeneticists, right? You know, several people said they're not. I just, so for me, you know, dummy field doesn't make sense to my child, but to a semiconductor person, it absolutely does.
Well, no, that's really a bad analogy, because in that case, when you look at the microprocessor, that extra fill you're talking about is, you can tell by looking at it, if you peel it away and try to see what the circuits are doing, because that's what we do with DNA, we see what the circuits are doing. If you look at the circuits, you can tell there's nothing there, it's just fill. It'd be more like if you see busted circuits from a previous chip inserted in there. We never do that. We never put busted things from previous generations in there. And some of these genomes, are really huge. They're really bloated. Like, it's kind of funny if you look at the onion genome. Some of them are like 10 times bigger than the other ones. And it's like, why? It's just because the genome didn't clean it up so well. There's like a cleaning function that some genomes can clean up and some can't. And some of them just have a whole lot of age in there.
So my analogy may break down when we talk about circuits and W4. But I think what I'm trying to put out there in a way that, you know, I thought you and I might, you know, talk the same languages, that we may have partial knowledge. And in our wisdom, in our own self-important wisdom as human beings, you know, I've never met anybody as smart as me, and you've never met anybody as smart as you. We tend to think we know everything about something. This may be something that we don't.
Well, I'll give you an interesting example in the microprocessor business. There was a time when Intel and AMD had a big battle, and AMD actually copied one of the Intel chips, and Intel went after them. And basically, there's this thing called microcode in there. And AMD said, oh, well, we have this microcode, and Intel's like, oh, wait a minute, there's so many different ways to write this microcode, and it just happens to look like ours, and guess what? We even have bugs, and you guys have the same bugs. This is too much. And so AMD had to go into a separate clean room and write everything from scratch. So they basically got busted because you can see, even though they're lying, that they copied the code. And that's exactly what's going on with the DNA. You can see the copying.
So, if I understand your logic correctly here, Bernie, you're saying that with the pseudogenes, there are genes that are alike, and the only way, there are only two ways that genes can be alike. One is that they are inherited from a common ancestor, and the second is they were designed by the same designer.
Well, to make it more clear, I guess, is what I say is like in the olfactory sense alone, or sense of smelling, there's thousands of busted genes we have, and we know that busted.
I haven't talked about the busted genes yet.
Okay, that's what pseudogenes is.
We're talking about similarities between two genes.
Right.
There's only two ways they can be similar. One is a common ancestor, and the second is a common designer. Would you agree with that?
Sure.
Okay. So then the next step in your logic, if I understand it correctly, is that when we look at these things, there's some of them we can see that this one is functioning, and we can understand its function. And then there's these others that are similar to the ones that are functioning, but they're broken and they don't function. So is that correct?
They function in another species, but not in the other ones, right?
So, okay, maybe I misunderstood you. So these pseudogenes are you saying that they are broken in one species and not broken in the other?
Exactly, right.
Okay, so what you're saying, okay, so what you're saying is that there is a gene that in one species it's actually different between two species, and the one species it works,
exactly, yeah.
And the other species it doesn't work,
right,
because of that difference.
Right. Okay. Yeah, because it got chopped up, messed up somehow.
Well, wait a minute, no. So I'm trying to restrict ourselves to what we can observe.
Yes.
You said because it got chopped up, and we can't observe that.
They can.
We can't observe that it was chopped up. We can observe that it is different, and it's different in a way that could be explained by being chopped up. We don't actually observe the chopping. Is that am I correct there?
No, they do observe the chopping because there's actual, like, to make a gene to be expressed correctly, it has to have like the correct stop and ending codes on it. And if the ending codes are messed up, or if the gene is truncated, if the gene is not expressed.
Okay,
and so basically it's a retarded or chopped up gene.
So it is a partial gene.
Yes.
So I'm trying to be very, very careful to avoid the use of terms that infer going over time. For example, you used the term, you said we can see bits changing.
Yes.
And I believe what you actually meant by that is we can see bits that are different and we presume to have changed.
No, you actually see the change. You see an actual bit change.
So you watch it, before, during, and after the change?
No, you can see like the chimp DNA and the human DNA, and there's four different codes, A, T, C, G.
Uh-huh.
And you can see the exact code is ATT, and another one might be ATG. One bit change.
So you see two differences, but you didn't actually see them change, did you?
Well, the reason why, no, of course you didn't see
it. Okay, so that's my point.
But the reason why you infer it is because the other ones also have it.
Yeah, right. But I'm trying to be very clear and using language very, very explicitly that we see a difference.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So I'm trying not to use words that presuppose the answer by saying change when all I'm observing is a difference.
Right.
Okay. So we see differences, and you're saying that so when things are similar, there's only two explanations. One is common ancestry, and the other is a common designer. And with common ancestry, the explanation for one thing that is here that works and that's over here that doesn't work, the explanation is they descended from a common ancestor and somewhere along the line on one chain it got broken. Right? That's the one explanation. But common designer, then you said that the only explanation for them being similar but being broken in one and not in the other is that the designer is deceiving you.
Yeah, I mean basically.
Okay. So my point there is simply that you're presuming that the only reason for something being there is that it works in a way that you understand. There might be some other reason for it being there that you don't understand. And so the only way you can level the charge to the creator of being deceptive if the only reason for it being there is to work.
Well, the thing is, we know what working genes look like, and there's busted genes all over the place. Now, the thing is, you got to remember, this is what the argument seems to get turned around through similarities. It's not just about similarities. It's also about hierarchy, about how the similarities flow. It's like a pachinko machine. You can take all these different paths. Well, it turns out that if you put all the different species in order of how you think they would have descent, that's exactly how these pseudogenes are inherited. It looks like it's perfect inheritance. Okay, so it's like, why does this animal and this animal have the same broken gene, but not this animal over here? Well, it's because of their descent. It makes perfect sense if it's descent. But if you said God made humans and chimps and all and fish and everything separately, without descent, it makes no sense. Why are these footprints?
Your presumption there is that if you have a creator that is creating, he's created all these other species, and now I'm going to create a new species, your presumption is that he wouldn't remember what he'd done in the others?
It's not a matter of memory, it's putting stuff in that you don't need.
Ah, so then your presumption is that a perfect creator would only put things into the genome that you understand what they're for.
No, it's like I said, it's obvious. There's tons and tons of extra copies of genes and stuff in the genome. Like I said, some onions.
You're presuming to know how the creator would choose to, what he would choose to include and not include in the genome.
It's kind of like if you were going to go take a trip somewhere and you bring a little suitcase and your neighbor brings 100 suitcases. You say, what do you bring 100 suitcases for? Well, it's obviously he's overpacking. He doesn't need 100 suitcases. And it's like, you're both going on the same business trip overnight. And it's like, well, how do you know? Maybe there's a different reason he's got or something. It was like...
So yeah, you assume that you know something. You assume that you know something about the other businessman, and you know, you assume that you understand his mental processes enough to know what he would need and what he wouldn't need, and why he would do something, why he wouldn't do something. And that's probably good logic if you're talking about another businessman, because he's at least a creature of the same order as you. But to use that same kind of logic to presume to understand how a creator ought to do things, you're trying to box a creator into a small enough container to contain your intellect.
Well, you just got to look at the human genome. Look at what's in DNA, and you'll see there's just tons of extra stuff, extra copies. Sometimes entire chromosomes are copied, and
is there a problem with that? I mean,
not if you have a naturalistic worldview, but if you think God is
brilliant, why is there a problem with the creator doing that? I mean, one might just as easily say that there's a problem, of all of the, I don't know, what's the species that gets, of all of the eggs that a human woman has, that only a certain number of actually become humans. Or the number of seeds. I mean, how many dozens of seeds are there in a Douglas fir cone, and how many bazillions of Douglas fir cones are there on a given Douglas fir tree each year,
mm-hmm.
and how many of those grow into mature trees?
Mm-hmm.
We don't presume to think that there's something wrong because there's a superfluity there.
Well, it all makes perfect sense with evolution.
All the excess doesn't make perfect sense in creation, too. Anyway, I'm sorry, I have violated one of the primary rules, which is to ask questions. We've had a very good interaction. Thank you, Bert.
Okay. I'm going to give the floor to you. You want to go ahead?
Go, Chad.
Okay, so.
Oh, hit him in the head.
Okay, so. John, you've been saying, like, for the answers, for people who've been asking you questions recently, you've been using the Bible for your answers.
Mm-hmm.
And here's why I don't like that. It's because the Bible was written, like, over 2,000 years ago, and that was written by people who didn't even know, like, that the world was round, and yet they're trying to make a book for the answers almost of everything, and yet later on, people are still believing this. So why do you believe in the Bible?
As someone said earlier, thank you for the question. Someone said earlier, my belief in the Bible is based upon the authority of what I perceive is behind love. So I disagree with you, unfortunately, about they didn't know the world was round. The Greek philosophers and astronomers, they knew the world was round. These people were not unlearned whatsoever. I understand what you're saying. What I'm telling you is we like to be guilty because it's easy for us of something we call chronological arrogance, because we're in the 21st century. Nobody that came before us knows anything. And what I'm here to say is that Jesus, who lived, real man, in space and time.
Well, how can you know that?
That Jesus lived?
Yeah.
I don't think there's much debate on whether Jesus lived or not. As a real historical being, I don't think even your father would say he didn't live. So, Jesus lived. And the question is, how did he live? And the question is, was he unique? And I believe the scriptures testify that Jesus is not only unique as a human being, he's unique as a God-man. And so why I believe in the Bible? I believe in the Bible because of its internal consistency and the message that it has. I believe that apart from everything else that exists in our possession as human beings.
The Bible is being outdated.
How is it being outdated?
It was science.
So it's science versus the Bible for you?
Kind of. Science is outdated.
Well, I would say this to anybody. I would say this to anybody who believes that the Bible is made obsolete by science. I would say read the Bible. I would say examine Jesus. I would specifically say read the book of John and see if you don't examine Christ Jesus to be wholly unique in the history of the world. Wholly different than anything else that you've ever encountered. I would say that compare what you have before you with the truth claims of Jesus.
Okay, well, how about this? How do you know that God is real? Like, he's alive.
Well, how much time do we have?
You're supposed to summarize, I think.
Here's what I'll say about how do I know God is real. I believe God is real because, as it says in the book of Romans, all of creation, Romans 1. Let me finish my point. Outside the Bible, there's nothing for me that I'm going to base anything I believe on.
So you're going in circles. You're saying
I would say that all of us go in circles. All human beings. Let me finish my thought. You ask a question, let me answer it. All of us believe, at the end of the day, in circular reasoning. We want to say we don't, but it's true. What I would say to that, however, is you better be careful what circle you're on.
Yeah, but well...
I believe that the things I believe in the Bible are true because the Bible says they're true. And how do I believe the Bible is true? Because God wrote the Bible. Now, I'm not some guy sitting in a corner with my head buried in the sand, which many people in this audience might think I am. I believe it's true because it's internally consistent. I believe it's true because, as I said, Jesus rose from the dead. Is Jesus a man? If he's just a man, if he's just some guy that came and lived and did some cool things, then I'm a fool. But if Jesus is who he said he was, then I better bow down and worship him. Thank you. Yes, Gavin. The last question, Gavin, then we're going to sum up.
So this question is similar to two that were already asked, but it's a little bit different.
And Bernie, are you good at repeating
It's for Bernie. I am an atheist like Bernie, maybe not as certain 100%.
We call you an agnostic, wouldn't we?
Well, no, to me that's a metaphysical claim, so I won't be agnostic in the sense of Huxley claimed the word. But, and I do believe in evolution, but I also try to look at things from both angles. So, regarding the idea about broken code and why would a designer put that, I have some questions for Bernie. You're a chip designer for Intel, correct? Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the Intel AMD example, where Intel had some faulty code and used that as proof that the other side copied. Does Intel or perhaps some other chip companies sometimes deliberately put faulty code so they can use that as evidence in a potential lawsuit?
I heard they do, but I don't know, it's just rumors. The design teams are so big, I'm not sure if they do. But just one funny joke there is DEC, Digital Equipment Corporation, was a big company. And one time they put in their circuit board something like, when you care to copy the very best. And the Russians copied their stuff, and they put in there, you know, if you care to copy the very best. That was, it's kind of a joke. Because they don't know English, I guess, you know, so they're just copying the whole thing.
And do software companies sometimes, like Microsoft, or maybe not any particular name company, but do they sometimes deliberately put faulty code? And does that code sometimes...
I've heard map makers do that, too. They do that on maps sometimes. They put in some...
And sometimes when a human intelligent designer revises some software or some hardware, do they sometimes introduce errors unintentionally that get transferred into later editions as well?
Well, I don't think they'd ever put in an error, but you would probably put it, you don't want to create bugs.
I mean, accidentally get a bug in the software, and then that bug ends up getting carried into the edition because it had printed out.
I might be off base, but I think we might have hit
it. Because if that happens sometimes, with human intelligent designers, is it possible there could be a non-human intelligent designer that would also have faulty code, perhaps on purpose or accidentally, and that wouldn't necessarily be proof that it came about?
Well, like I said, the faulty code's not put in on purpose. It would be benign code, because no company wants to put in a bug.
Well, I thought you said you heard a rumor that sometimes they do put bugs in on purpose.
No. Intel has bugs, it's not by design, but they have bugs in their stuff, and hopefully they're not a severe bug, so you can still sell the product, and then somebody copies it.
But they designed the code, and as part of the design, there was a bug. Maybe it was not intentionally a bug, but it got in there, and it sometimes might be in later editions if they haven't discovered where the problem is. So just because we might see faulty genes, is it possible that it still could have been designed, and it might have been a reason for it, or maybe the designer was not perfect?
Well, two things. See, now, even if there wasn't a bug, the bug's kind of irrelevant. That's just extra icing on the cake. Mm-hmm. The main argument, too, is that Intel has certain microcode, and then there are different ways to write the microcode. And so how convenient or what a coincidence that this other company has the same microcode, and that not just on one code, but on these other codes, too. So So it's just too much to believe that was they just happened to do it randomly in the same way. You know, it's like if you're going to write a book and somebody else writes a book and they said, oh, I did it all by myself. Turns out they saw this word for word. You can say, no, that's a copy.
So but
I don't care what you say. That's
what
a copy.
I'm saying is, you know, let's just talk. Let's not say God. Let's just say some intelligent designer, extraterrestrial, theoretically could do some genetic engineering, but had some bugs in there, and then later came out with a new model, and not using some of the older code in the new model, and not fixing some of the bugs.
But these bugs,
it might look like it was common descent, but it was common design elements introduced. Is that a possible way?
Well, the bugs in the DNA are not getting fixed. They eventually go away, or maybe get clotted for something else.
So your point, Gavin, is that God might have done all this so that some other God, when he copies, he could sue them in the court of law.
I'm not making that specific argument, but maybe just like the people at the software or microchip industries had a specific reason, perhaps, for doing something. Maybe another designer could have had specific reasons for introducing code that doesn't quite work right. Or maybe he didn't catch
but
an
again,
error
it's not just recycling. It's not just similarities, but it's also the placement of them in hierarchy, the way according to descent.
But who arranged the hierarchy?
Who arranged it?
Mm-hmm.
They arranged them first based on fossil record by phenotypes and the way the bodies look. You know, these look like they're similar.
And
then with DNA code, they could actually fine tune it.
Who arranged the fossil record?
It's just logic. It's like these things look very similar, so let's put them closer together.
But when you speak of like an order of descent, see, that was why I was saying when they revise the product, that's like descent. You came up with version 1.0, version 1.2. Yeah,
right.
You could line that up as descent, mm-hmm. But in that example, it's actually being intelligently designed. It's a descent in the sense that they're reusing some of the code, but it is still by designer. So maybe if someone was a designer for an organic system, maybe they would use some of the DNA design in one model in a later model. Maybe there was an error in the code that they didn't catch.
Well, I think they
put it there for some reason that we can't conceive of.
I think the thing is you're confusing different kinds of evolution. Like there might be a theistic evolution maybe. See, if you look at the big picture, there's really two main options. Humans evolved from other animals, or they're made from scratch. Those are two different options, from scratch or from other creatures.
What about the intelligent design?
Intelligent design is from scratch.
Yeah. So in Genesis,
you know,
when...
Because you said Michael Bay was made from self-design and evolution.
Yeah, that's for
I've
humans.
I've been a horrible moderator, and I apologize.
Yeah, but he said there's some parts that are irreducibly complex,
yeah,
and I mean all ones.
Yeah, it's 12 after 8.
Yeah.
I think we know where he's coming from, so I'll talk about that.
Okay, well, let's end it there as far as the questions are concerned. Any last thoughts, Bernie?
Yeah, you want to have like a 1 minute closing or 2 minutes?
Close it, Bernie. Sure.
Okay, we can each have like 1 minute, I guess, or something. So I'm just going to say, in conclusion, you know, I want to say that if you say, I know Jesus exists because I feel him in my heart, I feel led by God and all that. I was there. I was a born-again evangelical Christian. I know exactly the feeling. And like I said, I would have remained a Christian if I could just find one thread to hold on to, and evolution was one major thing. But because I fell into a group that actually also received evolution, believed in it, I stayed with it a little bit extra longer. And then for me, another knockout punch was learning about neurology, which I think shows there's no such thing as a supernatural soul, and if there's no supernatural soul, of course the whole gospel is gone because there's nothing to resurrect and all that. So that's just the big picture, and I just want to put out there that if you see the world through naturalistic eyes and thinking, everything will make sense. And if you don't, if you try to look through the Bible or something, you're going to have all these mysteries and say, well, I guess someday God will answer this problem or that problem. But I honestly don't see any problems with my worldview. One Christian said, oh, every worldview has problems. I don't understand, there's no philosophical problems, no self-conflicts or anything, so.
In conclusion, I would just say that for me, it's funny that you mentioned that you fought really hard to be a Christian, and I fought really hard not to be a Christian. The Lord changed my life, my thinking,
I've fought the truth claims of Christianity for a long time, and I find some of them, except the fact that they're true, pretty absurd, to be quite honest. The idea that the gospel centers on a man incarnate, you want to blow your mind? Any of you want to have your mind blown, try to believe that that God became flesh? That's incredibly difficult to believe. For some of you, for some of us, perhaps impossible. But God became flesh. God took on the form of a man and lived among us. And so, at any rate, I believe that the Bible is clear. There is an Adam. There is a whole host of implications we didn't get into tonight that I wish we could talk about as far as what it means. If there is no first human family from which we descend, it's pretty dark if that's the truth. And in fact, I believe we're seeing, because of the thinking of the modern day, I believe we're seeing some of that borne out even as we speak, what it means to dehumanize one another because we don't have souls or because we have no relationship with the Creator God. So I believe it's true. I believe the Bible is clear that it is true. And in spite of whatever good evidence you think you presented tonight, Bernie, I don't think that it's settled science at all. I'm not a scientist. And you might be on some other field, but not in this one. So I guess we'll have to close it there tonight.